Hello all, this is an important episode on art and we have with us today Parul Kiri Roy. Parul Kiri Roy is an architect, academician and art historian. You know, she's currently the assistant professor at the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi in the Department of Architecture. She's the founder member of INDES, that is the Investigating Design organization that believes that design should be an everyday phenomena and people should engage with it. The society should engage with it. And, you know, the society and the people should be empowered and design should be the tool for their empowerment. She's also an associate with CASP, that is the Center of Art and Social Science, Social Practice, sorry, where she facilitates community-based art practice. So, ma'am, how are you today?
Great. I'm doing good, Raja. Thank you for inviting me over.
Thank you, ma'am. So, ma'am, I would like to, you know, first quote the Minister of Housing and Urban Development. He was talking about art. He said that, you know, public space is an opportunity to display creative artwork. Not only does it beautify the cityscape, it also captures its soul. So today our conversation is going to, you know, revolve around the soul part of this sentence that the minister spoke about. So ma'am, you know, as architects, you know, we start our graphics in the first year and we are so close to art as such. But I want to ask, how close can art be to architecture and urban design when it comes to real practice? So, you know, to start with, I want to ask about art, public art in general. Should the taxpayers' money be used to make public art? Can it be, you know, more important than some people may say, a rationalist may say, more important than putting a public water fountain? What do you think about it?
So Raja, in my understanding, art has always been an integral part to architecture across time and space. What I mean by saying that is that across various cultures through time, art has always been in context of its architecture. What we understand as art today, as being an object in a gallery or in a museum, is a phenomena that happened much, much later, maybe the last 300-400 years. So in effect, art has been always there in the public sphere, with architecture forming the setting for art, right? Art has played multiple roles in architecture in the past. It would sometimes adorn certain sacred architecture, where its role was to communicate to the devotee, to narrate some of the mythological stories, to create a sort of a mood, an emotion in the mind of the devotee as the devotee begins to enter into this sacred space. It was meant to be part of the journey from the outside to the inside, from the profane to the sacred. Now, when you're talking about whether we should be investing as a society in art, my take obviously would be that we should, because at the end of the day, one could use art as a tool to shape and evoke the emotional aspects in people, in the human mind, you know. So there is, of course, the argument of the rationalist, where one would say, but we have more important tangible physical infrastructural aspects to take care of. And one would say, yes, they cater to the physical being of the human being. But what of the emotional being? What of the sacred being? You know, so I would imagine that we would do good if we keep some sort of a balance, and invest in public art simply to shape the emotional life of the human being, where the being kind of is also addressed.
Absolutely. So, you know, you spoke about invoking or evoking some kind of an emotional part of the human beings. So I want to ask you that, should art be really focused on, sending good messages across? You know, people usually tend to have posters made of public messages and all that. And some people look at art as, you know, a way of making posters of public messages like TB, like family planning, or, you know, like graffiti based on that. So is that the only way we should look at art, or is it like art should be art the way it is? So what do you think about it?
So, you know, in my mind, you're mixing communication design with art just now, because I'm not saying artists cannot take up everyday issues and create art around those issues. But the kind of conversation you're bringing up just now is more about, you know, communicating or passing on a certain message. And today, considering the kind of disciplinary domains we have created, that probably lies with communication design. While I feel that art, if you leave it the way it is and is to be understood, is having the potential to inspire and motivate and evoke in the mind or in the experience of the human being to a level where something deep within gets stirred. You know, something you may achieve which is of a certain value that was probably missing in your life. And art actually has that kind of potential where it can touch, move, and inspire you within and add value to your life.
Absolutely. So, Imam, yeah. You spoke about what can art do. But, you know, I want to ask you this basic question again. What, according to you, is art?
So, it's a very tricky question now, Raja, to answer in, you know, where almost anything and everything can become art, where artists are exploring all kinds of ways and means to create their art. But as I said, I believe that art is a means to awaken, you know. I would imagine a good work of art to make the spectator think or feel or emote in certain ways, where you feel touched, where you feel maybe intellectually enlightened, or you get somewhat of an experience akin to the sacred.
Absolutely. So, ma'am, with art being such a great thing, how can architects, you know, integrate art into the building right at the design stage? So I'm not talking about, you know, people making buildings, making their houses, and then later buying paintings and putting them. I'm talking about how can it be integrated right at the drafting board stage?
Raja, I sincerely believe that, you know, the first thing we all need to do is to break down those disciplinary boundaries, you know, where artists feel that, you know, this is art and architects feel, okay, this is architecture. And, you know, we tend to create these very well-defined boundaries. I think the boundaries never really existed in the remote past. And I think that the boundaries do exist today. And for a lot, many of us, they need to still sort of get diluted, you know? So if an architect is interested in, you know, integrating art, then you would have to, well, get an artist on board right at the beginning, you know? And definitely the user, the owner of the house is, you know, the person sort of calling the shots. So in that sense, the owner of the house needs to also be in the loop, right? So what kind of art would go into that person's house would be quite dependent on the users of that house, right? On the people who will inhabit that house. So I think it's fairly just bring on the all the people involved in the process of making that house together right at the beginning, and then create form and space where art and architecture work together.
Absolutely. So ma'am, you know, we spoke about you being an associate at the Center of Art and Social Practice. What is the kind of work that is done there, and you know, how does it impact the society?
So let me give you a example of one of the projects that we finished before the pandemic had struck. So we were trying to create child-friendly learning environments in government schools in East Delhi. So we took it upon ourselves that, you know, right, it has to be a learning experience, but it also has to be a joyful learning experience. So how do you create interventions, installations, which learn something, get them to understand a certain, let's say, social issue or an environmental phenomenon, or simply a math lesson. But how can that be done in the most playful of ways, which brings a certain joy to learning? So we created a whole range of, I call them art products or art processes, which were then very strategically located in the space or spaces of, you know, the schools, and children would come and engage with it every now and then. So there would be, you know, everybody knows the snakes and ladders, and the traditional snakes and ladders game is actually about vices and virtues. It's not just a game of numbers, right? So we brought back the idea of vices and virtues, and we said, let's engage with the children to understand what for them is a vice and what for them is a virtue. So we did some kind of a workshop with children, and they sat and drew out certain events from their own lives, you know, some which they were proud of, so that was a virtue, and some that they wanted to hide away, but you know, we still got them to realize that it's all right. And we can make mistakes, but we got to learn from our mistakes, right? So then they drew out what they thought was an incident, which was probably a bit of their vice coming through. And we integrated their drawings, you know? So the children being the artists, we became only facilitated within the game of the snakes and ladders, which was then installed in the corridors of the school. So, you know, children would come and go, and on the way they would play and, you know, be reminded of, you know, what are the values you need to stick with. And what are the vices that you need to get rid of, you know. So in their everyday life, they were being reminded of the goods and the not so goods that you need to inculcate in your own character as human beings. Yeah, I'm just giving you this one example to illustrate the nature of that project.
Okay. Thank you. I think so it's about bringing art to their life and, you know, making sure they interact with it and, you know, in a way that it doesn't just restrict itself to just their art book, but it's also right there in their school, in the corridors and everywhere around it. So, you know, with that, you know, I want to ask you this question regarding modern art that, you know, just came to my mind. You know, there was this BBC documentary on What is Beauty by Matthew Collins, in which he particularly spoke about modern art and said that modern art looks beautiful only because of its surroundings, because it is placed in very well lit and well designed art galleries. So what is your take on, you know, this abstract kind of modern art that we see around these days?
So I feel that, you know, what you're calling abstraction is also coming from a certain series of historical events, so as to say, right? But my take, I think, is more on the fact that, you know, art is put in galleries than works of abstraction in themselves first. So I actually believe that, you know, a gallery is in a strange way a misrepresentation, you know, because it's removed from any context, right? It's some kind of an imaginary kind of a context, right? And works of art get read in and understood in ways very different when they are actually put in a certain context, which is where I would agree that, you know, certain abstract works of art would do very well in a particular contextual setting. And in that setting, then, you know, a somewhat just one colored or two colored kind of a canvas, which would be considered to be a abstract work, would also evoke a certain experience in the spectator.
Absolutely.
Right. But when you go and put so many of those paintings all together, then they just tend to become a repetition or maybe a mundane set of things. But when it goes and becomes one in a setting, it takes on a certain presence, which at another level makes one conscious of one's own presence.
Absolutely. So, ma'am, you know, earlier you spoke about how you did this great work with these kids and you painted the snakes and ladders in the corridor. So, ma'am, I want to ask you, you know, this is a small little step of democratizing art. So I want to ask, in a city level, how can art be, you know, democratized? How can people start to own art? How can we prevent art from being a top-down approach?
By first recognizing that everybody is capable of creating art. So the first thing that needs to be really understood is that creativity is there within every human being. And when you begin to open up your mind into understanding that the people of the city themselves can be engaging with the processes of art, you would tend to break down that, you know, top to bottom kind of an approach, because then you're saying that it's not some artist somewhere who has come here to in your city, in your public space, to come and create a work of art which distances you in a certain way as the people of that city, because you have no real engagement except that you become a mere spectator. So the moment we begin to take the people of the city as being more than just mere spectators and become artists themselves, where they slowly become makers of art, and there are processes which enable that, you know. So there's a difference between taking an artwork and inserting that in a public space, vis-a-vis creating art processes where the people passing by, who are emblematic of the people of the city, become the creators themselves, right?
Absolutely.
So yeah. Those kind of processes can definitely enable more public art to happen, which would include the public, which would bring the views of the public in, say, certain matters up forth. So we've done one more such a project. We of course could not continue it to its ultimate goal, but the process was where we went into a self-built community, like an informal settlement, and we worked with the women of that settlement, and the women essentially were asked, what is missing for you in the place where you are living? So because they were all living in this, you know, what you would call a slum, some women said, oh, we don't have clean drinking water. Somebody said, we don't have a proper school for our children. So there was a whole range of things that came up from the perspective of women living in that settlement. And we made a list, and then each of these women were very skilled. You know, they knew embroidery. So they sat with us and embroidered their little point, which then, you know, went and became a large tapestry. So through that kind of an art process, we actually came up with what I thought were issues faced by women, which stops them from claiming, in a way, their right to the city. You know, if they are in the city, they have a certain right to the city and all that the city is to bring to them. And here were these women who were obviously struggling with, everyday matters, and which were big enough issues for them. So these were processes through which we actually brought out those issues. So the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, there are various ways of looking at art where one could set up processes of engagement with people in, multitude of ways.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, this is a great learning that through art, you actually brought out the issues that were subdued, that were, you know, not coming out of these women. And, you know, it actually represented a larger goal of, representation of all in the society. So, ma'am, I want to, we've covered a lot today, and I want to ask you about architecture. So if, for example, the client doesn't want a lot of art and he doesn't want to spend on art in a building project, how can you do art in architecture at a low budget?
I actually don't believe that art needs to always be this expensive matter. You could simply imagine all the various forms of folk art in this country, right? And you don't need too much money to create good art, honestly. But I understand the kind of concern you are bringing up, because you're saying that the client doesn't really want art. How does the architect still, integrate art into spaces? So I think at one level, I would even go to the extent of saying that architecture itself has the potential to create emotive experiences in space, right? So one could create forms in such a way that would evoke a certain kind of sense of aesthetics or a certain feeling in people. Having said that, I still feel that if the if the architect is creative in their own approach, then it's not so difficult to bring on artists of various statures to come and contribute to those spaces as well. You know, you don't always have to get an M.F. Hussain kind of painting to integrate art into spaces. There are a lot of artists who are very, very talented in this country and would be very happy to work in, you know, projects with architects.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, ma'am, you know, a lot of learning today. You know, you spoke about how public art, you know, should be democratized. You spoke about how art can be integrated in buildings. You spoke about what you think what art is. You also spoke about the great work that you do at the Center of Art and Social Practice. So, you know, with all this learning, I want
it's now
to
called Council for Arts and Social Practice.
Come again, ma'am? Center for...
It's now called Council for Arts. Council for Arts and Social Practice.
Okay,
it's
so for all the viewers, the Center of Art and Social Practice is now called the Council for Art and Social Practice. And, you know, the link for the Council for Art and Social Practice is right in the description below. And, you know, ma'am, I want to, you know, request you to, you know, leave the audience with a last message to motivate them and to inspire them about art.
So I have only one thing to say when it comes to art. I believe that all of us have the creative potential lying dormant within us. And currently, you know, we are all sort of struggling in our own ways. And I would like to let you all know that art also can be very therapeutic. So if you're feeling low and if you're feeling dejected or depressed, all you need to do is get some colors and get a sketchbook and just begin. And just dabbling with some colors would, you know, uplift your mood. Just engaging with a sketchbook would create a certain calm in your mind that could help you heal.
Great, ma'am. So in these current times, the difficult times, people are dealing with a lot of things. People are in lockdowns. People are dealing with little mental health issues also. So art is a therapeutic tool. So we all pick up art and, you know, enjoy our lives. So thank you so much, ma'am. It was great having you in this episode. Thank you very much.
Okay, Raja. Thank you for calling me over.